Yeah, because again, I had all of this lumped into one test, and then later on thought that's way too much material. Well, I thought it was brought to my attention, it was way too much material. So I broke it up into two tests. So let's go with this is the 12 volt battery. So if it's 12 volts, a 12 volt battery, that means that when I'm going from left to right, I'm going to lose 12 volts in this nice simple circuit. If I throw another component in there, then it will be different. So I've got a 10 by 10, let's put a distance between. We'll put 10 centimeter gap in between them. Obviously, I hope not the scale. So let's see what we can figure out. I got these two plates that are 10 by 10. I got 12 volts. I know the voltage difference between them. Or sorry, that was badly worded. I know the potential difference, or I know the voltage between them. I don't know what the capacitance is. See, what I do figure out here, I know that I have some idea what the electric field is in between here. Because I know if I've got an infinite plate, my electric field, if this is, say, positive Q, my electric field coming off of it is the charge density over 2 epsilon sub 0. And we derive that using Gauss's law. At least that's my memory. Pretty sure we did that. Did I do that?
That was this part. Bingo, bingo.
Okay, got that part. He's got it in his notes. If I've got a negative plate here, I have an electric field going towards it because the electric fields go towards negative charges. So this is my electric field magnitude. Sigma over 2 epsilon sub naught. Now, sigma in this particular case is going to be a negative, which is indicating it's towards it. So we're already taking that into account. So out here, let's extend this. So over on the left-hand side, we have a total electric field of 0. Over on the right-hand side, total electric field of 0, because they cancel out. But in the middle, they add up. And I have a total electric field of sigma over epsilon sub 0. I also know that the my mind suddenly shot someplace else. Let me get back to where we are. Ignoring the vector piece for the moment. That F is equal to QE. I know that U is equal to, or delta U equals Q delta V. If I think about it in terms of a point charge, for a point charge, and again, let me emphasize point charge. Don't use the point charge formula in other cases. For a point charge, this is KQ1 Q2 over R squared. And for a point charge, this is KQ1 Q2 over R. notice the differences. This is missing distance at the bottom, and this is a scalar vector. My electric field for a point charge, KQ over R squared, and for a point charge, delta V equals KQ over R. Notice that the difference between these also is just a distance. We can generalize it. I'm hand waving mass bits of calculus here. So that we have my electric field magnitude is just equal to my voltage. Divided by some distance.
So do you hand wave calculus?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
That means I'm skipping over a lot of the, I could do a more thorough derivation of what I'm coming towards, but it requires calculus.
Okay.
So I'm looking at a simplistic, hey, it works in this case, let's just assume it always works. Now, if the distance between them is D, I have my voltage is equal to my electric field times D. So I will sometimes refer to this as the Ed equation. And notice that if I'm going in the direction of my electric field over there, my electric field is going to the right. But as I move to the right, my potential drops. We can write this more explicitly with a negative sign there. We can get one step further into accuracy. That my electric potential is equal to the negative of my electric field dot displacement. So if my electric field and displacement are in the same direction, my electric potential will get smaller. Also worded as electric field points in the direction of the decreasing electric potential. Now I did some hand waving over there. Let's get more specifically about when can we actually use this. This is true if the electric field is constant.
So, if you could say it again, you said the electric field points in the direction of the decreasing potential?
Yes.
Okay. And then this is only if the electric field is constant.
Well, the electric field pointing in the direction of the decreasing electric potential, that's true.
Okay.
This equation specifically is true if the electric field is constant. Or, for those who've done some calculus. X, R, whatever letter you're using.
So the D is just R?
Just a- yeah. I mean, that. Again, it was a leap going from a point charge formula to a generalized formula, but that's the argument I was making. So between these two plates, I know I have a potential difference of 12 volts. I know the distance, so I can figure out what that electric field is. So let's do it. Any questions on the, did I just say plus? Any questions on the thing that I just made disappear? So, in this particular problem, I know that I'm going from left to right, so negative 12 volts equals my electric field. Electric field and displacement are in the same direction, times 0.1 meters. my negatives cancel out. I'm left with 120 volts per meter is equal to my electric field strength. Volt per meter. What else is that?
A voltage meter.
What is the normal SI units for electric field?
Newton per coulomb.
So we have a volt per meter is equal to a newton per coulomb.
Is there some sort of correlation we can make there?
They're both equal. No, there's no greater insight yet. Later on, when we bring time into it, I will start coming up with those arguments of time. Lead to one of my favorite test questions of all time that students despised, and it was badly done, but.
We will be given said question?
No. There were 15, there was multiple choice of 15 answers. Which of the following are units of time? And.
Let me guess, it was all of them.
No, well, I mean, there was some just bizarre stuff there. Now, to me, it's a great question because actually all but one of them were units of time. One of them was just the letter S, which I think people were psyched out at that point because half the class missed the S. What I did not take into account was how much time it would take to do each one to verify whether it's a unit of time or not. But I still like the question. Anyway, that's the magnitude of my electric field. And I know for my parallel plate capacitor there, that has to be equal to sigma over epsilon sub zero. Epsilon sub zero, because I got nothing in between, it's just empty space. So I can figure out what my charge, surface charge density is. So that is 120 times epsilon sub zero. So that's 120 times 8.85 times 10 to the negative 12th. Say this is volts per meter, and this is coulomb squared per newton meter squared. And someone's about to tell me what that is equal to.
What is the symbol above the epsilon zero, the reverse cube thing?
This?
Yeah.
This is a lowercase sigma. It represents charge, surface charge density. Here's the brain, here's the incredible genius of it. Surface charge density starts with the letter S. Sigma starts with the letter S. Let's use sigma.
1.062 times 10 to the negative 9.
I second such.
Yes.
Coulomb squared per meter.
Coulombs per meter.
Not coulomb squared per meter.
Is it just coulomb per meter?
No.
I assume volts has to go into there somewhere?
Not necessarily.
Oh, okay.
Because I forget to get that relationship too.
Coulombs per meter squared?
Say it again?
Coulombs per meter squared?
There we go. Coulombs per meter squared. Surface. So it's surface charge density is the charge divided by the area. So the units of charge over units of area. So closer to going from here.
So is linear charge density coulombs per meter?
Yes.
Oh, is meters per volt the same thing as coulombs per newton?
Yes.
Then you like throw them?
Yes, you can.
So we could have written that as, no.
Could have written it as a newton meter per, let's
doing a coulomb is a meter newton per volt, so volt meter squared, that cancels with that, so it's also a newton per volt meter. That just flows.
All right, so now we know what the surface charge density is. We know what the area is. It's a 10 by 10. So therefore, the charge on it is equal to area times the surface charge density, which is 100 square meters, times 1.062 times 10 to the negative 9th coulombs per square meter, or newtons per volt meter, which is equal to 1.0062 times 10 to the negative 7th coulombs, or 0.1062 microcoulombs. Fun with units.
I thought microcoulombs was 6.
Micro is 10 to the negative 6th.
But that's 10 to the negative 7th.
I also moved the decimal point over. Instead of 1.0, I had 0.10.
Oh, okay.
Questions are here. All right, so at this point, we can figure out what the capacitance is. Because I know the capacitance is the charge divided by the voltage. My charge is 0.1062 times 10 to the negative 6 coulombs divided by 12 volts. I have it still. Why? I don't know. I was originally going to write micro, and then I changed my mind after I started.
Why is it 12 instead of negative 12?
Oh, when you're doing capacitance, the capacitance of something is always the positive number. It technically, absolute number. Five times 10 to the negative 9th units. However, coulombs per volt is too much to write. So they decided, let's come up with a single word. So I introduce to you the farad.
Or is it?
That's three lines, as in by definition. If I do the equals with three bars, that means it's true because it's defined that way.
No, the top of the F is
that's just
a normal F.
Just
dead
handwriting. A farad named after
Dr. Farad.
No. It's one of those cases where they, for some reason, did not feel like writing down the whole word. It's named after Faraday.
So, you put three on the equivalent. equals y again?
That means they are equal by definition.
Because we said
so. Yes.
So then so if it was just the two, that means they're equal by magnitude?
No, if they're just the equal, that just they are equal, as in over here it's just an equal sign because they didn't define volts based upon Newton's coulombs and meters.
Okay, but they do end up being equal there.
Yeah.
But this is the definition of it being equal.
Yep.
Okay.
So 8.85 times 10 to the negative 9 farads.
Do you prefer one over the other?
Coulombs per volt or farads?
Yeah.
They're both equally correct. When I'm grading, I probably will have farads down there, and someone will come up with occasionally someone comes up with a bizarre unit and have to go, all right, but at least it's equal to each other, and so it just work out the margin. But okay, yeah, that's fine.
Now, this is just a totally random question. Would this farad ever be used with Fahrenheit? Do we confuse just yeah for there?
Not that I have dealt with. If there were a no, because if you're dealing with farads, most likely you would deal with Kelvin if you had some temperature dependence. Okay. Though if there is some temperature dependence, you could do it in terms of Fahrenheit, but it's degrees Fahrenheit, so that would be a difference you'd have to mm-hmm. degree something. All right, I know what you're thinking. This is great, but what happens if we stuck something in between? Well, from your minds to the board, let's do it. And I threw the pen down somewhere. So if I've got my parallel plates, this is positively charged and that's negatively charged, and then I stick something in between,